Okay, we'll get started. Gaurav, is it on? Okay. Okay, so today we want to talk about two-metric projection method. So that's section 2.4 in the book. And maybe some of you would look at Carmen and you will see that I have noted the sections and page numbers of whatever topics we are studying in the classroom. So you should definitely take a look at that. So the purpose of two-metric projection method is as follows. So remember, scaled gradient projection method, okay? And one of the variant of scaled gradient projection method is as follows, xk plus 1 equals xk plus alpha k x bar k minus xk, and my x bar k would be xk minus sk dk gradient fxk plus. Okay, so in some sense you are scaling the gradient in an appropriate fashion so as to get the best rate of convergence. And so this is one way of, we had introduced the scaled gradient projection method using a different formula, but you can think of this as another way of representing the same set of formula for scaled gradient projection method, okay? And the question is as follows. Let's look at it, what happens graphically. Okay, so say my constraint set X is X in Rn such that X is greater than equal to 0. So usually when you have physical quantity, physical stuff, then it has to have non-negative quantity, right? There's nothing known as negative stocks. There's nothing known as negative number of papers or negative number of books and so on, right? So it has to be a non-negative quantity. So suppose you are minimizing a function in this set, okay? You're minimizing a function in this set, and the function looks something like this. So these are the iso cost curves of the function. Okay, so this is C equals 1, C equals 2, C equals 3, okay? And here is the gradient. So let's say you are at this point. So this is your gradient of fxk. So say this is your xk. This is my xk. So this is my gradient. So this is my xk minus alpha gradient fxk. And let's say my dk is some diagonal matrix. Dk is positive definite, and dk is, I don't know, let me take it the second derivative inverse. Okay, for simplicity, let me take it second derivative inverse. We know this is known as the Newton's method, right? Constrained Newton's method. And when you multiply this gradient of f with dk, you get something like this. This will be my xk minus alpha k. Oh, did I write alpha? Let me write it as sk. Sk dk gradient of fxk. So what I want you to tell me, so this is that point. This is that point inside the parenthesis. This is the point. So what does that method say? I should project that point back onto the set, right? So let me project this point onto this set. So that's going to be right here. So this is my xk minus sk dk gradient of fxk projection. Okay. What is the value of function at this point as compared to xk? So let me call this as xk plus 1. So my question is f of xk plus 1 and f of xk, what is it? So let's say alpha k is equal to 1. Okay, so if alpha k is equal to 1, then this is equal to xk plus 1. And my question is, what is the relationship between the value of function at xk plus 1 with respect to the value of function at xk? What happens? Sorry? Fxk plus 1 is greater than f of xk. All of you can see that? Remember, this is the minimum cost. This is my x star. This is my x star. Okay, this is the point at which the cost is minimum. And as I move along that direction, or as I move along this direction, the cost of the function increases. Right? If it were an unconstrained problem, the minimum would appear somewhere here. Okay? But because it's a constrained problem, the minimum is appearing here. Right? But what is this Newton's method trying to do? The Newton's method is trying to reorient this negative of gradient, or this gradient of fxk, negative gradient of fxk, it's trying to reorient it so that it goes towards the global minimum, right? Unconstrained minimum. That's what it's trying to do. But when you project it back onto the set, what you're seeing is that the value of function is strictly greater than the value of function at xk, right? Can everyone see that? Is it clear? Okay, so this is not really doing what we intend this method to do. So we need to fix that problem. Okay, we need to fix this problem where the value of function increases for every value of sk which is positive. For every value of positive sk, the value of the function increases at the next point, next iterate. That's an undesirable property for any gradient descent method, because you want the function to decrease at every point in the iteration. So we need to fix that. Need to fix this problem. So let's see what is a way to fix this problem. So we can't take this method, will not always work. So we need to fix the problem. So here is how we fix the problem. So the question is, x is greater than or equal to 0, okay, and here is what I'm going to do. I'm going to define, so at every point xk, at point x equal to, how do I write, you know, if I write x1, x2, x3, xn, then you might just confuse it with the iterates x1, x2, x3, xn. How do I write the elements of x? Y. Okay, let me write it as y1 to yn. No, that doesn't sound good. Okay, I'll write it as x1 to xn. But note that this x1 to xn is different from this xk. Okay, so somehow n will denote the index of this vector x, and k will denote the iterates. Okay, so this is in Rn. I'm going to define I plus such that xi is equal to 0 and del f over del xi at x is equal to is greater than 0. Okay, so these are the set of indices where xi is at the boundary and the gradient of f with respect to xi is strictly positive. Okay, and I'm going to construct a matrix D in such a fashion that D is positive definite and Dij is equal to 0 for I in I plus of x, j equals 1 to n, j not equal to I. Okay, so let's see an example of what a D looks like. So let's say my I plus of x, let's say my n is equal to 5 and I plus of x is equal to 1, 3. So what would my D look like? It's a 5 cross 5 matrix. So D1 has to be positive. So D11 is going to be positive. But all other elements in this row and column are going to be 0 because of this condition. So 0, 0, 0, 0. Okay, what about D22? So D22 is fine, D23 is fine. No, D23 may not be fine, okay, because D32 is equal to 0. So this has to be 0. And then D24, D25, and then, so this is my D. Okay, again, 3 is in this I plus of x. So therefore, D33 has to be positive, but all other numbers have to be negative. And then D24 will be here, and D25 will be here. And then this will be 0, 0. And then we'll have D44, 4, D55, 5, and then D45. And D45. Okay, so the matrix D is going to look something like this. Yes. Last two lines, it's symmetric.
Oh, it's symmetric.
Right, it's a positive definite matrix. So this value and this value has to be the same. This value, and these two values have to be the same. Yeah, I was tempted to write D42, but I knew that D42 has to be equal to D24, so. Okay. So here is the result. So let me define x of alpha as x minus alpha d gradient of fx plus okay, where d is constructed in this fashion. Okay, so d is constructed. So in order to construct the d, you first have to find what are the indices which satisfy these two conditions, and then you have to construct this matrix d according to this fashion. Okay, it doesn't matter what these values are, as long as d is positive definite, you're good. Okay, so d has to be greater than 0. Then result one is x is stationary if and only if x equal to x alpha for every alpha greater than equal to 0. Okay, so this is a candidate. This is a candidate for optimal solution. And the second result is if x is not stationary, then there exists alpha bar greater than 0 such that f of x alpha is less than f of x for every alpha in 0 alpha bar. Okay, so it's the second property that's most desirable, and it gets rid of the problem we had seen initially. In other words, you have this function, this is your x star, this is your xk. Okay, so you will always make sure that your xk minus alpha k dk gradient of fxk is such that its projection, you take the projection, you get xk plus 1, and your f of xk plus 1 is always less than f of xk if this dk is constructed in this fashion. That's the point of this method. Okay, questions? So you are essentially the points that are active, that are on the active constraint, okay, xi is equal to 0, and the gradient is positive, you are not rotating this vector in such a manner that you are going in the ascending direction. Okay, by making these values equal to 0. Of course, the proof is there in the book, and it's fairly long proof, so you have to go through it carefully to figure out what's happening mathematically. Okay, but the idea is to not rotate the vector in a direction so that the, even though the function is increasing, the projection, sorry, the function is reducing, the projection is in the increasing direction. Okay, so that's the underlying idea here. What is an obvious choice for, so of course D11 and D33, you can make it positive, right? Any positive number, 2, 3, 5, whatever you like. Okay? What might be an ideal choice for picking this matrix, D22, D24, this sub-matrix, okay? By removing this row, this column, and this row, and this column and this row. Okay? So let's say Oh, by the way, I have two comments to make. Should I delete this part? Has everyone noted this down? I have two comments. The first comment is, you would ideally want the submatrix D22, D24, D25, you would ideally want to take it as a matrix inverse of x2 del x4 or xij inverse, this is at xk, okay? You want to take the inverse where I and j do not belong to I plus of xk. Okay, so that is a choice of this submatrix. Okay, so you take the derivatives, the second derivative, xi, xj, you create a matrix, you invert it, but you make sure that these ij's are not in this, are not in this set. Okay, so that's comment number one. So that's almost like Newton's method while avoiding the pitfalls of Newton's method. So that's one idea. The second thing that happens in implementation, you are never really at xi equal to 0 in MATLAB. Okay, if you are implementing this, what is 0 in MATLAB? It's some 10 raised to minus 5. Okay, so what you do is, when you are implementing, you just write that if xi is less than, I don't know, some epsilon, it's strictly positive. Okay, so you put this epsilon parameter in MATLAB when you are implementing this, so that you don't keep oscillating, especially around these points, okay, these corner points, because then this will turn out to be the whole thing, right? And you will not be able to find a feasible direction to go in. So you always put this kind of constraint, so as to make sure that you are always better off, you are converging. And actually, theoretically, you can prove that you can converge in this fashion as long as you are picking your alpha k according to Ermijo's rule along the projection arc. So those are the two comments. So if you are implementing it in practice, this is number one thing you can try. And this is number two things that you should try so as to ensure convergence. Yes? This one? No. So this x, well, you know, that's what I was saying. This I is the index, so this is not xk. Okay? So yeah, that's. Okay, so this is xi, not the iteration k. You know, here is how I can write it, xki less than epsilon. Okay, is it clear? Any other question on this? So let's move on to the next algorithm. Oh, I have a lot of time. Let's move on to the next algorithm, which is known as manifold suboptimization method. And it is similar to simplex method. How many of you have heard of simplex method? Simplex algorithm for linear programming. A few of you. Okay. So let's study that method now. Okay. But for general nonlinear problem, it doesn't necessarily have to be a linear problem. So more generally, it's called manifold suboptimization method. you know, I want to give you some historical tidbits about this method. So this was initially proposed for linear programming. And it was known as simplex method. Okay, and I think it was developed around 1940s, but I may be a little wrong about the date, but around 1940s, the simplex method was developed for linear programming, and it was a very powerful method, because at that time, remember, this is 1940, okay? So at that time, in 1935, linear programming was sort of devised in Russia. The person got Nobel Prize in 1975. His name was Kantorovich. Okay, so that he devised this linear programming problem, and then he used it. Maybe he used it, or he may not have used it, but the government might have used it to figure out how to send supplies to the troops fighting in World War II. Okay, and so it was kind of difficult to solve that problem until simplex method came into existence, when it was a polynomial time algorithm to solve a linear programming problem, the first polynomial time algorithm to solve linear programming problems. So that's what we are going to study, except that we will not be looking at linear programming, we'll be looking at arbitrary nonlinear problem. But simplex method was devised, and then in 1983, a much faster method was devised. And we will study that method. I forgot the name. Interior point method. Okay. So in 1983, interior point method was devised by a researcher in IBM. Maybe Bell Labs. Okay, a researcher in Bell Labs, and Bell Labs patented that algorithm, so nobody used it for the next 20 years. Okay, but they didn't really earn that kind of money from preventing others from using interior point method. After 20 years, that algorithm was open to public, and so everyone loves interior point method now. Okay, but simplex method has been used predominantly in the history to solve linear programming problem. In the worst case, this is bad. This is better, but typically, people use either of the two methods. This one turns out to be faster for many of the problems we use in practice, or we solve in practice.
So just to confirm, the difference between linear and
nonlinear
is just the objective function.
Just the objective function.
Or the constraints also?
Well, so manifold suboptimization is only for linear set of constraints, okay? But typically, you can have a nonlinear program. So in linear program, your constraints have to be linear. But in nonlinear program, your constraints could be nonlinear too. Constraints can be nonlinear. As long as you have, well, right now we are focusing exclusively on problems that have a convex constraint set. Okay, but later on, we'll talk about cases where you have non-convex constraint sets. Okay, so that's the history of linear programming. So let's move on to manifold suboptimization method. This is minimum of fx such that ax is less than or equal to b. That's the problem we want to solve. Okay, so what is the idea? So remember, AX less than equal to B looks like a enclosed region, or like a region which is covered by hyperplanes all over the, from all the sides. Okay, so for instance, this Remember the box constraint, right? A is less than equal to x less than equal to b. That looks like okay, something like this. So that's a box constraint. So we are looking at problems of this type where the region is such that it can be so this region is comprised of hyperplanes, and the area or the volume inside those inside this set surrounded by these hyperplanes. Okay, so it could be something like okay, like this. So this is also a convex set, right? This is a house. okay, so that's also a convex set, or you could have a plane. So in two dimensions, you could have a plane. This region. Okay, this is an infinite plane. It goes all the way to the infinity on both the sides. So this is another set of constraints which looks like this. So that would be x greater than equal to x1 greater than equal to 0, x2 greater than equal to 0, and x1 plus x2 greater than equal to 10. Something like this. Okay, so the constraints can be written in this form. And the objective is you want to minimize a nonlinear function or a convex function or a linear function over this set. And the idea of manifold suboptimization method is as follows. You start from some point, okay, and you start moving towards the edges. Once you get to the edge, and you are always reducing the value of the function, okay, so you don't just move in arbitrary direction, you move in a direction so that your function value reduces. So you're trying to reduce the functions. Once you get here, then you start sliding along this edge until you reach this point. And throughout this process, you are minimizing the value of the function. Okay, then you start moving along this edge, and you try and minimize the cost. Then you start moving along this edge, then you minimize the cost, and then you come here, you minimize the cost, and then you get to the optimal point, which might be somewhere inside the set, or it could be just at this surface. So what's the key idea here? At every point of time, you are trying to always slide along one of the edges of the set. Okay, so in this case, you will move in this fashion. In this case, suppose this is your x star, and you are starting from here, so you will get here. Then you will move here, then you will move here, then you will move here, and then you will get to x star. Okay, so at every point of time, you're trying to slide along the edge. So that's the idea behind the manifold suboptimization method. Is that clear? Okay. So I want to talk about some initial steps that you need to take in order to solve a problem using this method. So the first is you want to remove redundant constraints / variables. Okay, so that's the first step. The very first step is to remove redundant constraints for variables. So to give you an example, suppose you want to minimize f of x such that x1 plus x2 equal to 1 and 2x1 plus 2x2 equals to 2. Okay, so this constraint is redundant, right? So you have to strike out this particular constraint because you just want to maintain the minimum number of constraints possible. Sorry? Yes, but this one is specifically, so once you when you are implementing this algorithm, this is specifically very sensitive to having redundant constraints. Okay. When you are given a problem that is of very large size, finding which constraints are redundant is also a very difficult problem. Okay, it becomes a combinatorial. It becomes combinatorial in nature. Okay, so of course you need to make sure that you want to remove redundant constraints as long as you can do that. Of course, then you can write codes that can remove redundant constraints automatically. So that's first step. The second step is as follows. Let's say I say that x1, 0 is less than equal to, x1 is less than equal to 5, x2 less than equal to 10, and then I have x1 plus x2 plus x3 equals to 20. Okay. So there are no redundant constraints here, but are there redundant variables? Variables that can be removed from the optimization problem completely. Right? So let's write x3 in terms of x1 and x2. So 20 minus x1 minus x2. And then I'm going to change this constraint as to 0 less than equal to 20 minus x1 minus x2 less than equal to 7. Okay? So I have removed redundant variable Okay, so now I have my problem over two variables instead of three. Okay, we started with three variables with an equality constraint, and then we replaced the equality constraint. We replaced one of the variables with the equality constraint in a manner that this variable got removed from the optimization problem completely. Okay, so that's the first thing you have to do when you have to apply this algorithm. Okay, remove redundant constraints or remove redundant variables in this fashion. And the second thing that we need to do is to find, so if you're standing at a point x, you need to find the set of active constraints. Okay, so that's number two. How do you find a set of active constraints? So let's say a of x is defined as I. So I can write this a of x less than equal to b as ai transpose x less than equal to bi, I equals 1 to m. Okay, there are m number of inequality constraints. So I can write a of x as I in 1 to m, such that AI transpose X equals to BI. Okay, so this is how I define the set of active constraints. So for instance, if you are in 3D and your constraint sets are okay, so this is one surface, so this is constraint number one, there will be constraint number two on that direction, and this is constraint number three. These are the three constraints. Okay, so you are enclosed by these three surfaces. That's your set of set over which you are minimizing the function. So if you're standing at this point, this is your x, then your a of x equals to what? So this point is standing at which two surfaces? 1 and 2, right? If I am at this point, this is my x, then my a of x is 1 and 3, right? If I am at this point, then my a of x is 2 and 3. Okay, so that's my defining my set of active constraints. So when you are implementing, of course, you have to make sure that you put some tolerance here, 10 raised to minus 5, 10 raised to minus 4. So AI transpose X minus BI, the absolute value of it should be less than 10 raised to minus 4. So that will give you the set of active constraints when you are implementing it. Okay. Now my next question is, remember the idea is you always slide along this, along these lines, right? So my question is, if I want to go along this direction D, what should that direction satisfy? What kind of equation should that direction satisfy? Any thoughts? So let's look at it. A1 transpose X plus D should be equal to what? So I'm looking at this X and I'm taking a step in this direction D. So A1 transpose X plus D should be equal to B1, right? And A2 transpose X plus D should be equal to B2. What does that give me? A1 transpose D should be equal to 0, and A2 transpose D should be equal to 0. Right? So I'm going to move in a direction D such that A1 transpose D is equal to 0, and A2 transpose D is also equal to 0. Okay, so that's my descent direction. So I'm going to define at this set of active constraint, feasible descent direction S of xk as xk plus d such that AI transpose d is equal to 0 for all I in A xk. Okay. That's my feasible descent direction at every point of time. Any questions? Okay, so I'm given a problem. I want to solve it using manifold suboptimization method. So first, I remove all the redundant constraints, I remove all the redundant variables, so I have the minimal representation of that particular optimization problem. Then what I do is at every point x, I figure out what the set of active constraints is. And then once I know what the set of active constraint is, I figure out what the feasible descent direction is. Okay, and the feasible descent direction must satisfy this condition. So I'm always moving along this edge until I reach this point. Okay? So, yeah. Yes. So both these directions would satisfy the, would be in the feasible descent direction. Both of them will be in the feasible descent direction. Both of them are feasible. Now you will pick the direction according to what? Where it, yeah, whichever is reducing the value of the function. Okay? Sorry? We have to check both. Okay? So I am at xk, I am at xk, let's say. So I have two options. The first is xk plus alpha dk is feasible. Feasible descent direction. Oh, I see. The reason is why I shouldn't have written descent direction here, because I'm not checking whether it's a descent direction or not. It's just a feasible direction in which I can slide. Okay? So there shouldn't be a descent direction here. It's a feasible direction. I have to check whether it's a descent direction or not. Okay? Whether I'm descending, whether a function is reducing the value or not. Okay? So you want your dk to be a feasible direction, and you want this point to descend, okay? So that's one thing to check. If that holds true, then of course you will go and descend, right? So I'm standing at this xk, and I know that this dk is a feasible descent direction, so the value of function is reducing, so I'm going to descend along this direction, and I reach this point xk plus 1. I'll choose an appropriate value of alpha, okay? Now, once I reach xk plus 1, what happens? Okay, so there are two feasible directions. So it has, the set of active constraints here is all three. So at this point, xk plus 1, my axk plus 1 is 1, 2, and 3, right? So my s of xk becomes 0. Okay, so I have a problem. There's no feasible direction here. So what do I have to do? Any thoughts? What do I have to do? So my question is, remember from xk, I came up with this descent direction, picked the value of alpha, so I reached this point, xk plus 1. Now this xk plus 1, the set of active constraints at xk plus 1 are all three planes, right? All three planes are meeting at this specific point, right? So the set of active constraints are these three indices. So my question is, so once you figure out that, well, A1 transpose D equal to 0, A2 transpose D equal to 0, A3 transpose D equal to 0, it means that D has to be equal to 0. Right, so A1 transpose D equal to 0, A2 transpose D equal to 0, A3 transpose D equal to 0. Remember, D is a three-dimensional. In this case, D is a three-dimensional vector, and A1, A2, A3 are all linearly independent. Okay, so now I'm in trouble, because what it says is D is equal to 0. So these equalities imply that D is equal to 0, in which case I don't have a feasible direction to descend. What can I do? Yeah. Yes. Right? So I'm going to remove one of these active constraints. So fine. So then there are two cases. A, either xk plus 1 is optimal, so I need to check, or there exists a set of active constraint that can be relaxed. So there exists an active constraint J bar that can be relaxed. Okay, so I'm going to remove in this set AXK, XK plus 1, I'm going to remove, let's say I remove number 2. Okay, so there exists a J bar that can be relaxed. So I'm going to remove 2 from the set of active constraint, in which case I can descend along this direction, which is the intersection of 3 and 1. Okay. So I started from a point. I figured out a feasible descent direction. I descended along that direction. Then I hit a roadblock where the set of active constraints are all the constraints. Okay, so my descent direction, the feasible direction became an empty set. Not an empty set, but zero. Okay. So this is not good because it means I cannot descend anywhere else. So what does that mean? Either xk plus 1 is optimal, which we need to check. Okay, we don't know yet whether xk plus 1 is optimal or not. So we either have to check whether xk plus 1 is optimal. If that is not true, then there has to be an active constraint that you can remove so as to allow yourself a feasible descent direction along which you can start descending again. Okay, this is the figure. So you came here, you hit a roadblock. The set of feasible direction became equal to zero. So now you relax this constraint too, so you can start descending along this direction. So the question is, how do we know whether xk plus 1 is optimal or not? So that's question number one, and or a local optimal. And the second question is, if it is not a local optimal, if we are able to check that, how do I find which constraint we need to relax from the set of active constraints? Okay, so that we will talk about it in the next class. But remember this picture throughout the next class. Okay, think about it. How do you figure out? So you have to think, how would we solve this problem and how would we solve this problem? Okay.